very good morning, Luge fans, and welcome to event number two in the 2020-2021 Eberspecha Luge World Cup. Altenberg, Germany is the site for this morning's doubles competition. 40 degrees in Fahrenheit, 31 degrees is the ice temperature as we move along on a very, very windy day. It will be interesting to see how the conditions hold out for two races today. First, the doubles, to be followed by the women. Hi again, everyone. Tim Singer, pleased to be joining our Luge fans all around the world and pleased to be joined by my longtime broadcast partner, John Morgan. John, tell us about this 40-year-old track.
The track's a big challenge, Tim. You know, I've come here since the mid-80s, and, you know, there's been a few, you know, rebuilds of the track, but it presents a tremendous challenge for the athletes, especially the doubles. The big Kreisel here, the big 280-degree whip around. You know, the Kreisel's one thing, but you exit out of these curves 11, 12 here. This is, you know, again, high speed, a lot of G-forces right here. Little uphill section now on the track. And this is the speed part of the track right here. 75 miles an hour plus, you know, 135 clicks, 132 clicks. A lot of pressure, Tim. You know, the course has changed here in the finish area, but one thing when you come to Altenberg, you better put your seatbelt on.
And that's what 22 teams will be doing in today's race, the first nine of them having qualified yesterday in the Nations Cup. Stressful one-heat race in order to get into this main World Cup field. Number 16 there, Shoy and Kohler, double winners on their home track in Innsbruck. We'll see if they can parlay that success into more success around the world. Incidentally, Shoy and Kohler also won the World Cup last year here in Altenberg. So clearly they're comfortable not just at home. So sit back, get ready for some lugeing, another full weekend on the World Cup tour. In case you'd like to share, and a big hello to that young lady in the middle of your screen, Margaret Dengler, the media woman for the FIL. If you want to share in today's live streaming, by all means, tweet us at Luge Announcer. You can also email us your questions and comments, luge.announcer@gmail.com. Underway with our first team from Moldavia, Siskano and Ofria. John, great seeing this small country between Romania and the Ukraine now regularly on the World Cup tour.
Yeah, I don't think we saw them last week in Innsbruck.
We did not see this doubles team. They did not qualify out of Nations Cup. There was one Moldavian singles athlete.
Well, Romanians, you know, they had a track up in Romania back in the, you know, Romania's been sliding in the sliding sports way back in the 40s, came out of Southern. In fact, I think in the 32, 36 Olympics, they had a chance. So they're sliding tradition, so it's nice to see this young team here. They're the rabbits, they got the ice, best ice to work with. You look at the glare. Temperature seems like perfect for sliding, too. I don't think we're going to see any deterioration in the track.
What's interesting, we'll talk about it in a second as we give you their finish time of 43.178. That man right there, the former singles luger, Maciej Kurowski, he took over the reins of the FIL team last year. Those are the small nations. And Maciej, the Polish bear, very proud of what he's been able to accomplish bringing these young athletes along in just a few years.
They didn't get up, Tim. They didn't get all the way up to the finish. They got the sled turned sideways. They don't want to go backwards. But pretty good technique here. You know, the getting on and off these tight turns here in Altenberg. A little different than the track we had in Innsbruck last week, Tim, for the athletes. But they didn't make it all the way up to the finish. I dare say you will see most of the other teams make it all the way up. Track looks in excellent conditions, far from the track record for sure.
Just how far a 43.178 is, nearly 2 seconds off that mark. As we get ready for our second team from Czech Republic, Filip Bidejak and Zdedek Pekný. And John, you were talking about the conditions and whether they'll hold, and they should in today's weather. But boy, we've been here in Altenberg many days where the biggest challenge was frost on the track, around the track.
That's usually when it's a little bit warmer than this, Tim. So I dare say I think we're going to see glaring ice for the whole heat. Then, of course, between each, they'll spritz, you know, for the second run. These guys got 18th last week at Innsbruck at the opener. And, you know, pretty consistent, you know, 18th, in fact, in both heats. So, I mean, consistency is a very important element of these sliding sports.
They are in the green and .366 well out in front. So our early speed, just to let you know, 106 kilometers an hour is 65.9. I believe we get another speed trap. No, that is the speed trap. So 42.892, and the Czech Republic moves out in front.
As expected, Tim. And you see how far they came up the ramp under there. That's a second plus better.
Just getting started here. Two runs of World Cup doubles. Later on today, we've got the women's competition. Ooh, they rode high off of that wall.
Problems down there on the speed part of the track. That's down 13.
Now we've got Yor Hua and Rostislav Lekjevic. You want to try those? Take a stab at those names, John?
You did such a great job, I shouldn't even worry about them.
I don't know about that.
21st last week in Innsbruck, very consistent. 22nd, 21. And two trips down the track. You know, the track, again, an old East German sports center built in the mid-80s.
Yeah, completed in 81, and it was pretty much a secret for 4 or 5 years.
Well, they kept on blowing it up and changing it because it was so difficult. But I was here in 87 for the Dresden Cup of bobsled racing. It was all fogged in, pretty challenging. But I've seen a lot of competition on the track, Tim. And this is one of the three or four tracks in the world that really challenged the slide. Only 400ths. Lead here into the finish. They should hold on, and they do.
They do, extending down at the bottom of 42.503. Early going here. The Eastern Europeans have all taken to the track, and it's Ukraine leading over the Czech Republic and Moldavia.
Entrance to the curve one, you know, where do you want to get on the takeout early? A little amount of steering here is possible when the speeds are slow.
When I first covered a race here, which was well after you first covered a race here, but it was about 25 years ago now, 27 years ago, I believe they had a chairlift or some sort of lift.
Yeah, they took the sled back from the top, yeah. Well, the finish area was off to the other side of it where we are now, Tim. And there was a chairlift that took the bobsleds and I guess the Luge sleds too, right up to the top. They did away with that about 92. It wasn't there for the World Championships, I think, in 91.
This is the first of two, or three, rather, Russian or Austrian teams in today's race. Gott and Schoch, both just 19 years old. Clearly the youngsters in this very strong Austrian program. And John, Austria has been good across the board so far. Doubles, men.
Great last weekend.
Yeah.
These two young kids, they're good starters. They had the fifth best start of the second run last week, which... You know, I always emphasize the start. I don't think the start is as important.
Right. Depends on the track.
It depends on the track.
And what's amazing, and I'll talk about it in a second as we take care of their business, crossing the finish line or approaching it, still in the green. And they are with a 42.430 for Coach Renny Friedel, former German luger, has been coaching the Austrian program for many years. John, in Winterberg especially, that one is glaring because the women's start is just below the men's start, but there's this big ramp that leads from one to the other. And for the women, it's like 9 or 10 paddles. For the men, it's 3 paddles. So there is not uniformity, for better or for worse.
And paddling, as you and I both know, look at the good lines in the Kreisel. Get as many waves in the Kreisel as you'll see for the men's luge.
Curve 9, though, a challenge. All of the sliding sports. And for doubles here, as the Koreans are getting ready, Park and Cho, it's interesting. We talked yesterday about the entrance to Kreisel. Not yesterday, John, but last week in Innsbruck. Here it's somewhat similar. Curve 9 hits these doubles athletes pretty quickly. So if they make any tap in the first one or two walls, they're just not going to make up from that.
Now, you can't gain time on the way down, Tim. You can only prevent yourself from losing time given your start, your sled, your gravity. But, you just don't want to touch anything if you don't have to.
And that's the exit of 9, just like that, in the straightaway to Kreisel.
A little drift on the exit. He always comes over into Kreisel, gets over on the left side to take on early. And look at his feet moving to try and maneuver the sled. And 600 in the red. But on the bottom part of this track, Tim, you can find there is a fast line. A little uphill section there.
Speeds have all been very consistent amongst the first several sleds. To the finish line, they've been in the red. They stay in the red. Third place of the first five that have come down. That's Yingyang Park and Young Myung Cho. The Koreans making a late decision to take part in the World Cup only about 10 days before the opener in Innsbruck.
Yeah, they were 20th place last week. Pretty consistent both runs in regards to 20th and a 19th in two heats. Looked a little bit here. Now he lays back. Entrance good. Quiet steering there.
The Koreans down, and we get ready for the first of three Germans. The young Germans in just their second World Cup race, Hannes Ola Munda and Paula Gobitz. And Norbert Locke, the head coach of the German program, was mentioning after Innsbruck that the doubles on Hull had a brutal competition. They just were not competitive, Norbert lamented, but he was very quick to point out that the highlight of the weekend was this young doubles team. They did well, and John, Norbert predicts they will be on the top of the world before too long.
Well, he would go, Tim. He trained how many Olympic champions?
Quite a few. Like the last several with the Tobies.
15th at the start last week in both runs. A little surprised at that, Tim. Obviously, he must believe these are speed merchants, because if you have a deficient start, it's tough to get up the top of the podium. 11th overall in the race.
Sixth then the next day in the sprint. So that was a great showing in their first World Cup weekend. Still in the green at this point. Their speed at 67.1 miles per hour. Here to the finish. The first of three German sleds. The others are world champions and Olympic champions. But right now, they are a first-place team. John, nearly a half second
half
up
second.
On the field.
That's a lot of time, Tim. If you look at the other three sleds, they're 46, 53. No, they're separated by 10, 13 hundredths. This young German team comes down in almost a half-second lead. Tells you the track's fast. We're getting a little bit closer to the track record, Tim.
A little bit, yeah. Still a second plus away.
That looked a little late there. Came out the left side of the screen. Norbert's looking happy with it.
Yeah, I mean, that's one thing. He's got all these champions, but Norbert Locke has been great on about bringing along young athletes, giving them a lot of World Cup experience. Now the first of three Russian teams today, Vladislav Yushakov and Yuri Prokhorov.
Tenth place last week.
And fifth in the overall World Cup, sixth at the World Championships, which was pretty much a Russian celebration for 3 days in all of the disciplines.
I think that's called home track advantage. There's a great exit of 9, Tim. A little bit of a drift. 400's back. Similar start times to the Germans. Well, reversal of fortunes. The Germans are on their home track now.
Well, it's close. 14 thousandths. They're wavering a little in that straightaway.
Clean here. Yep.
7 thousandths.
They're bringing it back. This could be the first one we can say is too close to call, Tim.
And they fall
they
behind.
Lost, boy.
What's always intriguing is a track where red turns into green down below, and that's always a good sign, a fun sign for good racing the rest of the way out. Hey, John, you mentioned home track advantage. Lest we forget that I believe seven of the next eight races or seven of the six of the next eight will all be in Germany, not including the World Championships, which will be in Bavaria. So there'll be a lot of home track advantage for the already strong Germans.
A lot of home cooking. This Russian sled here, though, Tim, they're 7,000th out. Right about there, we thought they'd have a chance at the bottom, but they're 900s back, so they lost a lot of time in the bottom. Or was the German sled that much quicker in the speed part of the track?
And they tend to be here in Altenberg. Well, we have three Germans, we have three Russians, we have three Austrians, we have three Italians, and we have three Latvians in today's race. That makes up more than half of the entire field. Those nations, Martins Batz and Roberts Pluma, had a great World Cup debut last week with an eighth place finish.
Yeah, they have fifth in the first heat. They slipped to the eighth best time in the second heat, eighth overall.
Ooh, that's trouble out of nine.
Major. Little lazy steer off there, Tim. And boy, that just erases the opportunity to hit that maximum speed, to see his feet moving, adjusting the sled. World Cup debut. Green numbers still, though, Tim. That's impressive with that mistake. And they're on the wrong side of that straightaway.
Yeah,
tap before the take-on.
Speed is terrific. 67. That's right up there with the Germans. They cross, and they have the lead.
How not to do it, and they're the fastest so far. That was not a textbook run at all, Tim, but, you know, sometimes loose is fast.
And the man you saw there in the coaching box is the man that sets up these sleds, Martins Labenis. And with a couple of more Latvian teams, including the Sheiks brothers, still to come. Looking good so far in the early going for Team Latvia.
Yeah, eighth last week. It looks like they're going to be on track for eighth or better so far. This looks good here, Tim. They didn't show us the mistake out of nine. But sometimes loose is fast.
So a quick hey to several, as we get ready for the second Austrian team, Mueller and Frauscher, a quick hello to some of the people tuning in from around the world right now. Steve is watching from the USA. Of course, Ken is tuned in Durham, North Carolina. And Uda, who's about 20 meters away from where the sled is right now in the Altenberg press room. Thanks for watching our feed, Uda.
Well, here's our silver medalist from last weekend. You know, these guys had the fourth best time in the first run, second best time in the second run to move up under the podium. Good weekend for the Austrians finishing gold and silver on their home track.
Absolutely, and it was a landmark day for Mueller and Frauscher in just their second year as a doubles team, former singles competitors.
But they're behind the Latvians, and this is going to be close.
Green.
Oh, they got them.
They took it by 200s down at the bottom. And, John, that's what I was alluding to. It's always a little more fun when we can see red turn to green in the final few curves. That means things will be a little more unpredictable the rest of the way out.
100th or 18,000th of a second. He takes a deep breath. You know, well, our silver medalist from last weekend, red numbers all the way down the track, Tim, but they pulled it out on the bottom. Look at the entry into curve one. Looks like they get in there in their terms. That looked a little late. Curve nine, that's the same thing we saw the Latvian sled do, but they didn't hit the wall as hard as the Latvians did. Probably why they're in the lead by 1/100 of a second.
Now the Ukrainians, Igor Shtakiv, Andrei Lisetsky, both from Kiev.
15th last week.
They won the Nations Cup qualifying race yesterday, which was, I'm not sure there's ever been a time where they've stood on the top of any podium in an international race. So that means something, and it means mostly, John, that they like this Altenberg track.
Well, they don't get very good starts, Tim. They're 19th and 18th last week at the start. A little weird the way they went into that first curve. Looked to me like too much steering.
Yeah, they're still on a bit of a slalom course here entering the Kreisel.
Exit Kreisel into this two-toner combination here that's as tough as it gets in any track in the world. Big pressure here, 13-14, and now the little uphill section. Clean there, speed. Well, they're half second back, so this is a fourth or fifth place ride.
Ukraine,
6,700.
Way back in eighth place, 42.6. Wow. And again, we didn't see gigantic problems, but you allude to it a lot, John. It's a culmination, or, you know, a cumulative effect of a lot of steering, right?
Well, I didn't like the way they got around that first curve. You know, that was not a quiet steer. But, you know, we've seen a lot of different sleds have different angles into that first curve. Here, curve 9, now we've seen a lot of sleds drift left. This, not as bad, but, you know, sometimes if you steer too much, Tim, you're slowing yourself down. This is late there. Look at his foot, tumbles come down, and crossover wasn't too bad.
Okay, we turn our attention to the top, Chmielewski and Kovalevsky. They had an interesting season last year as they've been emerging over the last few seasons. They were in the lead in Innsbruck at the World Cup opener last season. They fell off of the podium in run number 2, but they were plugging away and finally had a podium position late in the season in Winterberg, their first. Great to see Poland on the podium.
Well, you know, Poland, if you go back to the records, Poland won a couple world championships in doubles and singles.
And they've been pretty steady over the last few seasons in the relay, meaning they have good representation in all three disciplines, usually top 7 or so.
In fact, pretty clean so far.
Nice exit there. So the speed not as good as the leaders at the moment as they approach the finish. 41.92, the time to beat. They are fifth place, a quarter of a second behind, without any real noticeable issues. Wojciech Chmielewski and Jakub Kovalevsky of Poland, eighth place finishers at the Olympic Games in the team relay.
Try to go through my notes. Yeah, the Poles got a silver medal in the 1958 World Championships in doubles in Krynica. So that might be, I don't know where that track is, Tim. I've never heard of it.
Well, we know it wasn't artificial because everything was done on natural track back then. And our next Russian team is set at the top. Kashkin and Korshunov, fourth place finishers at the World Championships last year. As for last week, they were back in 12th. And John, so here's a question for people to answer if they're watching. I'd like to hear your opinion on it. The final World Cup race has just been rescheduled. It was, of course, canceled in China, and it will now be held in St. Moritz, Switzerland, at the historic venue, St. Moritz Zell Arena. And does that make it a natural track or artificial track Luge race?
Tim, I mean, it's a natural track. It's the only one. Very successful, the Junior Olympic event that was held there last year.
Youth Olympics, right?
Yeah, it was great. Very successful. Everybody very positive. They do such a spectacular job on that track. I mean, it's so smooth. Look at this. Only 100 back. This is a good run.
Yeah, 200s, but the top three. So it's Austria leading over Latvia, Russia, and Germany. That's the top four. Just over halfway through run number 1. Yeah, John, and I have been fortunate enough to cover not only all of the bobsled and skeleton races, but the World Championships of Luge in the year 2000. There was a World Cup in 2012. So St. Moritz, few and far between, but always very welcoming to the athletes in the sport of Luge.
Well, you know, they put a bid in for the Olympics, Tim, and that's why they wanted to make sure Luge competitions were being held on the natural track. Look at those beautiful pictures. Crossover. It's on the take-on, looks like on his terms.
And to answer my question, it still would be artificial track Luge, even on the natural track, because the two formats are very, very different.
Yeah, yeah,
regardless you're right, of the surface.
Yeah, the natural track Luge, that video they sent, I watched that. That's very, very impressive. That's the old style.
Now our second entry from Czech Republic in today's race, Tomáš Vaverčák and Maciej Žmiš, both 21 years old. both still balancing studies with their Luge careers.
I think they made the field last week, Tim.
They did not. Oh, no, they did. 16th place. They didn't make the sprint race. They just missed out on that. And they're keeping it very close right now with the Austrians, just 200ths at that split.
Yeah, now they're looking. See, both runs, they finished in 18th spot. So they're consistent in the runs, which if you're young and aspiring to do well in the sport, you want to think of consistency from each run. Boy, that strange line there. That's cost him. You see how high he got there. So it got away from him a little bit.
And not only is this their home track, John, we are just a matter of a few kilometers away from Czech Republic.
We've been across that border a few times on our way to Prague.
Beautiful city. Just,
spectacular city.
Actually, we are in between two fantastic cities. Dresden, one direction to the north. Prague to the south. A little closer to Dresden, but just a gorgeous place to come visit.
Dresden's one of my favorite cities in Europe. It's the Paris of Germany. It and look how high they got there. You can see that and the exit here all the way into the finish. That must have cost them a little bit. Took too much of the curve.
They get the green light. That means no sled check, no weighing for them. It's an arbitrary system. And on we go now with another Latvian team. These are the brothers. Four-time Olympians, Andres and Juris Šeiks, last weekend at the World Cup opener. They had a very rough start with a 14th place finish, but then they proved they are still one of the best in the world with a second place in the sprint.
Good starters, Tim. Fifth and second best starts on the track in Eagles last weekend. Look at the way they get around. Ooh, they have a little body movement up there on the top.
Juris Šeiks, the bottom man, now the second oldest person in the sport of World Cup Luge at 37. But they are still doing it well, and they have a 5,000th lead here in the early going out of the Kreisel.
Exit into the two-corner combination. The most challenging two-corner combinations in any track on the planet. This is clean. Thousands, a hundred
still
back
very
though.
Close. Great speed, 67.1. The speeds
they
have
could,
been consistent.
They could get green numbers here in the finish, Tim. They could get close.
They do.
There it is.
Yep.
That's experience.
41.905. Latvia back out in front. In fact, right now it's Latvia, Austria, Latvia, Russia, and Germany. That's not a big surprise nationwide. Those are the big countries in doubles luge at the moment. But keep in mind, the front runners are still to come. The seeded athletes will continue.
Look at the exit of the curve. Look at his toes. These are great pictures here. Look at him put his head back. A lot of confidence. Well, you got that much experience, you'd have confidence. I wonder how many races they've been on this track here.
Yeah, quite
they've
a few.
Been, they've been 15 years together, right?
More than anyone, and that may include the German teams who are from Bavaria and Thuringia. Now we have a welcome back to the tour for the Russian tandem of Alexander Denisov and Vladislav Antonov. On course now, Olympic silver medalists back in 2014 in the relay competition. They missed last week's race due to positive COVID tests just before the season, so they stayed behind in Russia. They have now been cleared to race this week, as have all 118 athletes that showed up here in Altenberg.
Starts, very competitive. Ooh, toe comes down, curve down, looking to put his head back. Once he can get slight correction. Now 400s back. Loop there on the exit of the Kreisel, the last pressure point. Clean here, but 700s back and losing time.
Two podiums last year on their home track at the World Championships, playing with fire down here, hugging some walls.
Late
not
there.
Really a clean ride.
Late there, 15. 1600s back, wasn't clean.
42.068 puts them into sixth place. In fact, they're tied for sixth place right now to the thousandth of a second with their Russian teammates, Denisov and Antonov. How about that?
What's the odds on that? Tying to a thousandth of a second?
With another sled from your country.
Little drift there. If you put that toe out like that, boy, it's like throwing out an anchor. Here, watch the just a couple pressure points here. Watch the real high here above that line. Looks like he made some adjustments there, but lost time all the way down the track.
You see in the background there, one lone photographer. That makes up the entire spectator crew here, which is unfortunate, but we're happy to be racing. We're happy to have a World Cup, and the World Cup leaders who are certainly happy coming off of last weekend, the Austrians Stoi and Kola, double winners in the World Cup two-heat race as well as the sprint in their return from injuries from last year.
Yeah, that was a great comeback for sure. And they won both heats last week, Tim. Very consistent. Sixth best start in each heat. You know, they were just, they did it all on their home track.
And
see
as
what
I
they could do here.
Right, as I mentioned, their last victory last year before the injury was on this track in Altenberg, in Saxony.
Green numbers, 4-6. Watch how much pressure he takes there. That's not bad. 15, 8, pulling away, great speed.
Yeah, really good speed at 67.4 to the finish. The Austrians have the lead. 41.788, still exactly 4/10 of a second off of the track record, but well out in front of the rest of the field. It's Austria, Latvia, Austria, Latvia. That's the top four right now with still five to come.
Well, they certainly gave themselves a chance to maintain their World Cup leader position with this run. A little late there on the exit of 9, but corrected well. 11-12, head back, does a little peek.
It's nice to see a regular contender ready to fight the Germans in the sport of doubles luge. These Austrians are just that. Now we make our way back to the top for the Italian team of Ludwig Rieder, Patrick Rassner, a rare and pleasant podium finish for them last week in the sprint. They finished third. That followed up a fifth place race the day before in the two heat doubles.
The best starters in the field last week, the best starts in both runs.
Let's see how they translate there on this track. Third best.
Yeah.
They've been competing together for 10 seasons now, although each of them have been in the sport quite a bit longer than that.
Kreisel, slingshot out of the exit of Kreisel. Looks pretty clean, Tim. Still red numbers. Drift there, 300 speed, not the 108 kilometers we saw.
Could
from
be
the
a
Austrian
top three
sled.
Or four here. Rieder Rassner, not bad. 1,200s back. Armin Zugler seems pleased with it. And it's nice to see this veteran team back. They've had a couple of rough seasons, but podium last week, perhaps a top six this week, depending on what happens in run number two.
They're challenging the Sick brothers. Sort of talking with his hands there. Probably evaluating the good, the bad, and the ugly of the run. And here, tough to see any faults there. Beautiful pictures. Here down the wrong side of that exit of that little uphill section, but corrects well.
Okay, we get ready for the three-time world champions and the three-time World Cup overall champions. Up next for Germany, Tony Jaegert, Sascha Bennekin. Had a rough sprint, the only crash of the entire day, and finished 15th in that race, but they did podium the day before. Tony said after the race that they lost the race at the start corner, and it's been difficult to drive for them. And for Sascha, the bottom man on your right there, coming back still from injuries to his neck, and mentioned he's still a long way from 100%. When they are 100%, John, they're the best doubles team in the world.
Well, that looked like one of the cleanest entry and exits of curve one we've seen, but of course, they've got that bib on that says world champion, Tim, so this is, you know, green numbers as we would expect.
Now it's red.
We're still green.
And Jason Turdeman was mentioning to me they just didn't look that comfortable on the sled last week.
They didn't look good there. That looks like they got a little bump before the take-on.
Good speed.
Green numbers.
67.6 miles an hour. They should stay in the green, and they do, but by
eight thousandths
of a second. But that was a pretty emotional fist pump there by Coach Locke, who, frankly, probably just was not sure what to expect from Agert and Beneken.
Yeah, down the bottom part of the track, I think it was 11, 12. It's like they came out a little too early and hit the take-on. Can't fault it much, Tim. They're the leaders, but by only 8 thousandths. And again, they're wearing the world champion bib. Look at the little steer there. It's up top. Pretty confident run right here, I think, is watch the right side of your screen. Yeah, I don't know, maybe they hit the take-on perfectly.
Racing now continuing in Altenberg, Germany. The Germans have the lead, and their counterparts, the Tobies from Bavaria, will be last to go. But before they go, we have three other teams. Next from Italy, Emanuel Rieder, Simon Kainzwaldner. The bottom man, Kainzwaldner, spent a lot of time shuffling between partners before he finally hooked up 2 years ago with Rieder.
Ooh,
they've had some success.
There. Second bump there. So that, I don't think that's the way to do it. I mean, they looks like they made a mistake on the take-on, and then they had to steer hard to get off the curve. And already 1,400s back. This is a good team. At the start, Tim, they had the third best starts in last week's event. The Italians all have great starts. Oh, drift.
Armin Zugler, their head coach, was one of the great starters. That was one reason why he was so successful. Of course, he did it from top to bottom. They're way back here, John, quarter of a second.
I tell you, if they show us the start, I think you can see that there. Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't think he had a chance. They had a chance with that. Curve one. Boy, that's not them. That's 11th place. They were sixth last week, Tim, and very consistent. Well, I can't say consistent. They were second in the first run, ninth best time at the second run, and fell all the way to sixth.
And, and had a world championship podium in the sprint competition last year. They're coming along still. As I mentioned, just 2 years together, some good days, some bad days.
Watch this now. Watch this. Ooh, looks like they're hit that. They hit the bump before the first curve, and then watch them steer again here on this outlet. That sentenced them to the position they're in right there, Tim. Doesn't matter the rest of the run. If you make a mistake like that at the top, it's over.
Three more remaining in run number one, including the final Latvian pair of Oskars Gudramovic and Peteris Kalnins. Both 32-year-old veterans, both out of the capital city of Riga. Great to see that Zigulda will be hosting a World Cup race next month. And just coming off of 2 weeks of IBSF action, two-man bobsled, women's bobsled, and skeleton. And the track was in great shape.
Well, the improvements they made that track, that's a first-class facility. When I was first going up there in the late 90s covering, Tim, the track where the lights weren't that good and it looked a little rough, but the Latvians, of course, for good reason. They're good in these sliding sports, you know, with winning Olympic medals in luge and bobsled.
Not to
and
mention
skeleton.
The greatest they got those skeleton athlete
of all time. They got those guys up there called Dukar's brothers and seen some female skeleton athletes. So that little small nation, the most powerful small nation in the sliding sports. And
well
back, guys,
ninth place right now, 42.009.
They were 12th last week, so that might be better than what they posted last week.
Well, Latvia again, does have three in the top 10, and pending what happens with the final two sleds, they will keep three in the top 10, so a little bit of depth. around the leaderboard for this nation.
Little spikes on the figures. They paddle down to the start their descent down this legendary track. That exit of nine didn't help them. Watch the crossover here. It's almost a little bit like our zigzag, the old zigzag curve in Lake Placid, Tim.
They're zigging, they're zagging.
Zagging through zigzag on the way to 15. That was the
How many
call.
Times did you hear that announcement?
Quite a bit. Still etched in my mind.
Two remaining now. Final Italian team, Ivan Nagla, Fabian Malaya. Seventh place finishers at the Olympic Games. Part-time duty over the past 3 years or so as they've been balancing school, some military service, as well as their athletic careers.
When seventh not, go seventh ahead, last week. Seventh last week, Tim. And they had the second best start in the first run, the 12th best start in the second run. Can't do that in this sport.
Fastest
you got to be consistent.
Today, though.
Look at that. See, all three Italian teams. I think the Italians are the three of the top four teams at the start.
Well, they've obviously spent their summer in Muronsen on that start track, working on the first 50 meters or so. That's so important.
They've lost back that 400s lead. A little drift there. Seventh place last week. Seventh and sixth in the two runs. 900s back. Speed's a kilometer off the top speed. Should be a seventh or eighth spot here, Tim.
42.003. If you look at the splits, things are very tight right now between third place and eighth place. Only 700 separating it. So regardless what happens with the final slide here, we're going to have a good fight for the podium positions. And only 8 thousandths of a second, as a reminder, separate the top two sleds with one remaining.
That's basically a tie. Look at the lean up, the guy on top. They're on that first curve without having to steer, really. That was a little body lean. Here, look at his left foot. That's how he steers this double sled. Good lines here on the X11-12. Head back with confidence. Ooh, took him to tap the wall there.
One remaining now, and certainly a formidable final sled. It's the second week in a row that the Tobies are last to go in run number one. They absolutely know this track. Although they're from Bavaria, they've had plenty of time here in Altenberg. Four-time Olympic gold medalists, gold in both doubles and team in Sochi and Pyeongchang.
How many times did they practice that sequence right there? And that's why they had such a beautiful, quiet entry and exit of that first curve.
So the start time puts, it's the third fastest start time. They were shut out of the podium last week, but still top five in both of the races.
Much better start than last week, Tim. Their starts were 13th and 10th last week, not this week. So. Seeing the clock here.
Yeah, we're not. Yeah, we're.
Yeah,
we're
the
getting
clock's not
in
adjusted.
The right
so,
time.
Yeah, so we're getting just the run time, not the comparison.
Well, 41.78 is the time to beat, but
something wrong with the clock.
This
yeah,
is
going to
be unofficial, right?
So they're going to have to go to the backup timing. That's where they have two timing, but we noticed that right away.
Very frustrating for Norbert because although he coaches.
They're saying third. There it is. See, yep. That there's the backup timing, 400s back. But it's very much a striking distance for the gold medal.
I would say.
And it's hard to say good, bad, or ugly here. Beautiful, slow picture.
Well, one thing you can say is cohesion. They look like one person there.
Yeah. Well,
and that's. You know, that's just, I mean, they've done it more than anyone, really.
They probably spent more time in a wind tunnel than anybody, too.
The two Tobies, actually, we're still waiting. Yeah, I think what you saw on your screen is probably the right one. My computer is updated incorrectly, but let's assume we've got a Germany, Austria, Germany, top three right now. There's our good friend Finn, the Beastman Bear, in the background. As order is restored to some degree, because the four teams that are on balance, the best four in the world over the past several seasons, are the four leading. I think we might have a moment here before we get you these official standings as they just try to validate that Vendel Arp time. Nothing really surprising, John.
Nope. Same cast of characters, top of the leaderboard. Very impressed with the three Italian sleds with the three of the four best starts.
And furthermore, a track that yields pretty much as many crashes as any in the world was crash-free in the opening heat of the weekend.
Yeah, on a very, very challenging track, and wasn't record speed, Tim, but, you know, we saw some good lines.
Only coaches, media officials, and athletes allowed along the venue in an effort to make sure we have a COVID-free season on the World Cup Tour.
We saw our guy Ralph up there shaving the ice.
And our producer, Britta, has just informed me it is a timing issue, so they're just going to get to the bottom of that before we validate these results. USA fans are all too familiar with challenging the validation of results in the last few weeks, right, John?
Haven't noticed, Tim. Haven't noticed. Some kind of voting machine stuff going on. I don't know what it is. There's the bear. But
so this is just week number two. After this weekend, two more pre-Christmas competitions to be held in Germany. They will move not too far from here, about halfway between Dresden and Berlin, to the track in Oberhof, and then over to the western half of the country for the lone race this year to be held in Winterberg. And I know, John, you're hoping to make it here to Altenberg sometime in February.
Well, if the COVID situation relaxes, I'd love to go back to the World Championships and Altenberg. I mean, Tim, we'd be seeing 2,500, 3,000 people here for the Luge event. You know, they love their sliding sports in Germany. You know, they're the dominant nation. And
absolutely. We've covered a lot of World Championships here, I believe, in 2000 or 1999.
And
actually, we did the Skeleton Worlds in 99. And then 2008, they put on a big German show here, big festival for the...
And then last year, so, you know, I was there 91 for the first World Championships, and I can remember being about 20 below zero. Wolfgang Hoppe won... the two-man Roddy Lochner won the... the two-man Hoppe won the four-man, but... Luge World Championships, I think they've had at least five of them here, Tim. Let me check. I can tell you right now.
And while we're waiting for these results, John, you know, I just got a note in from our friend Paola, who's a big supporter and a media representative for the Italian team, who said that, you know, one of the reasons the starts have improved for the Italian doubles is that last summer they retained the services of three-time Olympic champion Tatjana Hufner, the German, who has been working in Cesana at that start facility with the Italian team. So there you go. Tatjana, historically, in women's luge, was the fastest at the top of the track.
1996 was the first World Championships for Altenberg, and the second one was in 2012, Tim, for luge.
So just 8,000, we'll get back to that in a moment, okay. Just 8,000 separate the top two. It's going to be an incredible run number two. Again, it's Egert Benneken, Stoy Kohler, Vendel Arp, and Sheeks. Those are the top four, with the Italians just out in fifth place.